Dear God, we thank you so much in our everyday life. Sometimes we don't recognize your mighty hands and your sensitive hands, how you lead us, how you provide us, how you tug in our hearts. And your amazing grace and tremendous love, you know where we are, every one of us. And you know how to encounter us, bless us, and show your grace and your mercy and even your power. And we thank you so much for working in the lives of all of us in such magnificent way, and also sometimes in such tangible and sensitive way. We thank you so much for your grace. Open our ears, open our hearts, open our mind and our eyes, so every day, every single second, we may be able to see your glory and experience your love. Sometimes you allow us to go through the trials, difficulties, but even those are your loving hands. So, Lord, help us to have a gratitude and thankful heart and be able to trust you no matter what happens in our life, because all you want for our lives is the best of things, is the gift and your love. And we thank you so much for wonderful testimonies being shared tonight. Father, we come before you. This time we want to open our hearts widely, and because we want to hear your voice tonight. Because your truth will set us free. Your truth is a light and a lamp on our feet. Your truth is a spiritual food that we hunger after. Your truth is a living water that quenches our soul and will give us a true satisfaction. Would you anoint my tongue with your Holy Spirit and help me to be dictated by your Spirit so that I may only speak the words that are only pleasing to you, and you want to speak to your people tonight. Would you be with us tonight? We thank you and we invite your presence. We long and crave for your presence. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. As all of us know, starting this year, starting with Pastor Han and entire congregation, we want to meditate God's word according to the schedule of the Bible time. And I want to ask you, you don't need to raise your hands because I'm a little bit afraid. How many of you are reading the scripture according to the Bible time? Can you raise your hands? I said you don't have to, but since some of you raised the hand, wonderful. That's awesome. Awesome. One of our staff, she was concerned we may only have about 5 people, but right now I saw we're over almost about 20. So a lot of us are reading and meditating God's word according to the Bible time. That's awesome, because tomorrow we are going to have a first cell leaders meeting, because we are going to talk about how we are going to implement Bible time during our cell meetings as well. So this is it. Whether you like it or not, we are in it. And we are trying to stir up not only campaign, but movement. I'm not elevating Bible time itself, but if you use the Bible time, you can recognize it. It's a plain and simple. You read the Bible each day, a small portion from the Old Testament and New Testament, because this is a schedule to read entire Bible in 2 years. So, for example, if you accidentally, let me emphasize it, accidentally skipped one day, and following day you can resume so easy because the portions you missed is not that large and you can catch up so easily. And also, from reading each portion, there's encouragement, because you don't have any other extra illustration or stories or things like that. It's plainly the Bible itself. Because the Bible itself is a word of God. And as you further meditate, and God will speak to you from that scripture, You don't know how many times, as you know, I preach God's word almost every Sunday, but on my daily reading, I will find some portions or some passages or certain verse that strikes me, and it's related to the sermon that I'm going to give on that Sunday. And God feeds me first so that I can share that same word and same revelation and prophecy with God's people among EM. And that's amazing. So God can speak to us from that designated portion, even though the people from Bible time have allocated that portion, but God can override human endeavors and still be able to touch our hearts and speak to us. So I strongly encourage you to read according to the scriptures. And if you have not joined our Kakao chat group or sharing group, talk to Pastor Rina and give your name and give your phone number, and you can be included there, and she will send out every morning the portions that you can read and also share with the other brothers and sisters. And then there's one verse that is encouraged from either Old Testament or New Testament that strongly stood out for that day and spoke to your heart or gave you further insight and revelation, whatever it is, you further meditate. And I encourage you to memorize that verse, and it can give you such power and strength and will give you transformation in your life. I shared this with our staff this morning when we are having meetings. Willow Creek is known for the church who will have a seeker-sensitive worship. And that church is one of the largest churches in America. And they had various conferences inviting people from all over the world. And they had wonderful programs that other churches would come and copy their programs and so forth. But their pastor, Bill Hybers, in recent years, he publicly confessed, in many ways, our church have failed in making disciples of Jesus Christ. Our church has failed helping our people, their lives have been transformed according to God's word. Programs, events, and conferences do have a certain impact to the lives of the people. But he confessed, but daily meditation of God's word, there's no other way for God's people, their lives and their hearts can be transformed with a daily feeding of spiritual food of God's word. And that itself will indeed transform the hearts and lives of the people. And just like a manna fell in the field during the wilderness to Israelites every morning, each portion will not last more than that day. More than that day, you need to go out early in the morning and to collect the manna for your day, for your portion, for your appetite. If you collect them, large portion that day, hoping it will sustain for tomorrow, because you are too lazy to wake up early in the morning and you don't want to go out to the field and you just want to collect a large chunk so that you can eat for a whole month without going out early in the morning. But tomorrow, that manna will become rotten and it stinks and you cannot eat it. That means the grace of God, the food, the spiritual food, every day we need to seek His face first, that we need to feed our soul with His word every day. And only then that we'll be able to hear His voice and our hearts should be transformed. And Bill Hybers, that he confessed openly, publicly, because that church influenced many churches around the globe. But that's one thing about great men of God. When he's wrong, he says, even though how much it will humiliate him, humble him, he will openly say, I was wrong, we failed this area or that area. And then also Pastor Han, our church, I'm talking about campsite, we have a basket operation. If you can read the Korean language on their bulletin, Sunday bulletin, they have an insert of all kinds of Bible studies, all kinds of discipleship programs, all kinds of things. You can come almost every day if you are willing to partake all kinds of programs. But Pastor Han also confessed, we realize no matter how strong, well-structured the programs our church provides to our people, once they're done, we see lives of the people, the way they conduct their business, their lifestyle, their behaviors, and even their communication, their conversation, oftentimes are shocking. Even though these church members haven't been coming to church for the last 10 or 20, 30 years. Unless, just like what I shared a couple Sundays ago, according to Psalm 1, blessed is he, the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly and stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, and in his season he shall bear fruit, and his leaf shall not wither. So that is the way. So while you partake, you come to a night of spirit and fire, you come Sunday worship, and there's Bible study offering to give you and to encourage you to further study, meditate his word. But let's continually meditate God's word. Let's make this a habit. Let's make this a habit. You may not be content with this portion according to Bible study because it's a 2 liter. To be frank with you, for me, it's a 2 liter. That food amount is a 2 liter for my own appetite. So I am well in advance in both the Old Testament and New Testament. But one thing that I like about this is because it's smaller portion, I can read further in advance. And if there are certain verse and passage, I would like to further meditate and spend more time, and I can relax because I don't have a pressure to finish that portion. So either way, let's all corporately come together. And some people say, oh, I have my own schedule. I honor that. I respect that. But if you are a leader, for the sake of your followers, for the sake of people who are doing baby steps, you model them so that you can encourage them to join that together. Join that together. And as an EM, with a Bible study, I mean Bible time, you've probably seen the cover. How many of you have seen the cover of Bible time? It's not second and friendly, as you can see. Even I myself, when I look at the cover, man, I don't think our people would like this. It's not too pretty or anything like that. But anyways, through the prayer, as our churches are doing it, why don't we join together? Because KM and EM, we are under the same roof, and we try to be united together, and it's one body. And what can there be any better way that we can be united together according to his word? So that's my encouragement. Let's continually meditate God's word. Having said that, and because of that, you probably heard the announcement starting year 2017 and Night of Spirit and Fire that initially my plan was going through the book of Acts. But we already studied it with the book of Romans. And then I felt like recently as I was praying, maybe our people on Sundays, they are going through the book of Romans. And Fridays, if they come, we are going through book of Acts. Maybe we may lose some sort of enthusiasm. So what I decided, I don't know, maybe later Holy Spirit may convict me to go over Book of Acts or different ways, but at least tonight, what I decided was share a portion of the Bible reading that we've been doing with the Bible time. And I already shared this portion with the staff, so if you are pastor, either you pastor, Ian pastor, this is the second time you are hearing this same message, that means it's an emphatic from the Lord, because Jesus himself also said, amen, amen. If anything is important, he said, amen, amen. So you are hearing second time, that means this is Rhema for you. Can I hear amen, pastors? Thank you so much for your enthusiasm. Pastor Elliot even doesn't murmur his mouth. Amen. So I'm going to select a passage from today's portion in the book of Genesis. This is the life of Abraham. As we know from chapter 12, Abraham was called out by God. And he said, go to the land that I will show you. And as Abraham was obeying the voice of God, he stepped out in faith. He didn't know where he was going, but he heard the voice of God. And he used to live in the land of Ur, but his father and his family moved to the land called Haran. And there, his father, Terah, died there. But he was remaining there, but God spoke to him again, and go to a land that I will show you. So he was following God's word, not the circumstances. Circumstantially, he shouldn't move because he has no idea what's going to happen. He doesn't know where to go, but he followed God's word. So this is secret. This is a secret to our success in our life. We should never follow opportunity. We should never follow money. When we choose a job or when you choose to move, we should always follow His voice and God's word. Not the circumstances, not the opportunity, not even money. People in the world say money speaks. But in the Bible, never. God speaks, we obey, and we follow His word. Let's remember this. Do not follow just because there is opportunity. Do not go just because there is more money. Do not move because of circumstances. Only move or stop because there is a voice of God, because there is a word of God. So Abraham, his journey of faith with God began by following God's word. And he studied really well. However, when the famine struck, instead of following the voice of God, he didn't hear to move down to Egypt, but he looked at the circumstance because in the land of promise, there was a famine. Just because God promised where we are, sometimes God gives us a promise and we are in the place where God wanted us to be. But that doesn't guarantee prosperity all the time. We will experience a famine sometimes. But because if there is a famine, do not move. But Abraham looked at the famine and did not hear the voice of God and moved because there was a famine. And in Egypt, he was humiliated because now he didn't follow God's word. Now there's a sudden fear in his heart, and he has to rely upon his own strength, and he's trying to build up his own life and cultivate it. And that's why to survive, he becomes selfish. He says, lie for me to his wife. Tell them you are my sister. And we know this story. He fails miserably here and there. But his promise is, I will make you of a great nation. I will make you a blessing for the nations. Now that promise, when he was 75 years old, was first given. As he was moving to the land of promise, he was 75 years old, and his wife was 65 years old. Now, Sarai was a barren. They had no single child, but God will give him a promise, I will make you a great nation. It's impossible. It's a ridiculous, it's an obnoxious promise. My wife is a barren. I'm 75 years old, and you tell me that you will make me a great nation and your name shall be great and you will be exceedingly fruitful and multiplying? Impossible. But God takes him to increase his faith because God is ready to make him a great nation, but Abraham was not. His faith has now reached to their level. So in many, many ways, we think we are being patient for our promise and our vision to be fulfilled before God. No, it's the other way around. God is more than ready to pour down all his blessings, all his promises to be fulfilled in our real life. The problem is we're not ready. We're not ready with our humility. We are not ready with our faith. So instead of me being patient before God for promise to be fulfilled, God is being patient. God is being patient with me so that I increase my faith, so that I truly believe his promise, even though my circumstances tell me against such promises. And God waits and helps me to grow my faith, because he only works when I believe. He only works when I trust him. He only works when I believe in his promise. That promise will become realization in my life. Only then he will work. So instead of Abraham waiting for 25 years, because we know when he reached 100 years old, they were able to have Isaac, the promise, first promise given to them. For 25 years, he miserably failed here and there. Sometimes he was successful. For example, when his nephew, Lot, was captured by five kings, confederate, because he was living in Sodom and Gomorrah. I don't know by what courage the man, fearful of his death, asked his wife twice, once in Egypt, once in Gerar, "Would you tell them you are my sister, not my wife, because you are too beautiful, and they will capture you and take you as their woman, and they will kill me." I don't know how beautiful women you have seen in your life. I don't think I ever seen any beautiful woman who is 90 years old that you have to lie. So I'm eager to go to heaven and see Sarah in reality and see how beautiful she is. And also daughters of Job, because they were so beautiful above any women in the whole world. Sorry, honey, I forgot that you are here. You are the most beautiful woman in the world, in heaven too. I said it. What have I done? I forgot. So Sarah, 90 years old, her issue of a woman has stopped. So it's impossible. So God had to wait 25 years. Now, Abraham had to wait 25 years. But in reality, God had to wait 25 years for Abraham to grow his faith, to really believe that God called me to be a father of many nations. Now, along the way, another failure, as he lied to other people about his wife, was he heeded the voice of his wife because he ran out of patience. Okay, God asked me that I will be a father of many nations and he will make me a great nation, but we don't even have a single child. And also, they become anxious. And Sarah said to Abraham, "Honey, since I'm barren, why don't you just go into my maid, Hagar, and just conceive a baby?" And he obeyed, because a man will never refuse that kind of suggestion. And he went in and had a Ishmael. And when we read the Bible closely, after they conceived Ishmael, and now because Hagar, her heart was puffed up because now I have a child, my mistress, Sarah, doesn't have a child. So she was despising her. And because now Sarah was treating her so roughly, Hagar ran away from home with a baby. But God spoke to him and intervened, "Return back to your mistress." So Hagar and Ishmael returned back to the house. From there, now we are going to read chapter 17, today's portion. For almost 13 years, God is silent with Abraham. God doesn't say anything to Abraham. Why? Because Abraham failed with patience. So God was testing him for 13 years without reminding him of any promise. And Abraham had to wait and wait and wait and live every day just a normal life for almost 13 years. Now suddenly, when Abraham is 99 years old, Sarah is 89 years old. Their bodies, according to Romans, are like dead bodies. Each woman has stopped long ago. It's impossible for them to have any child at all. If they enjoyed intimacy with one another, I don't know. But let's read what happens. And God appears to him, and he says this, and it's astounding. It's amazing how God can speak to Abraham like this. Let us read from verse 1, and let us alternate. Book of Genesis, chapter 17, verse 1. And when Abraham was 90 years old and nine, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God, and walk before me, and be thou perfect. And Abraham fell on his face, and God talked with him, and saying, neither shall thy name any more be called Abraham, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee. And verses 7 altogether, and I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee in their generations for everlasting covenant to be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee. This is amazing. If you really think about it, this is obnoxious, ridiculous promise God is giving to Abraham and Sarah. He's 99 years old. They never had a child. Of course, they had Ishmael. But by impatience, by distrust of God, it was a failure. Ishmael represents our failures, our scars, our mistakes, and our broken relationships. Why? Because we did not obey God's word. We did not make decisions according to God's word. We were not led by the Spirit. We did not act upon our faith, but instead, out of impatience, out of flesh, out of our own ambition, we begat Ishmael. I have begotten Ishmael all over the places. One good example is I went out to plant a church called the Low Inn a few years ago. I thought I was being led by the Spirit, but it was surely out of my own ambition. It was out of my impatience. God, when are you giving me the house of God under my care, under my name? It was totally out of ambition, and I have begotten Ishmael. Just like King David, out of his own lust, he has begotten through Bathsheba, a boy, and that boy was killed. Oftentimes we do that. In previous relationships, before I my wife, I also begotten Ishmael. What's female term for Ishmael? Ishmael, Leah or something. Because I was being impatient. I was not, instead of praying and relying and waiting upon God and follow after my eyes and approach the sister and begotten Ishmael. Couple of times. And all of us, we do that. We do that. We move by flesh. We become impatient and we do not act by faith. And every decision we make, we may end up begetting Ishmael. But the amazing thing is, God promised Abraham when Isaac was born, indeed the time has come, Sarah no longer cannot allow Ishmael mocking Isaac. So then Sarah said, cast this woman, bond woman out of our house because her son and my son cannot coexist and receive a same inheritance. Now, Abraham was grievous. Why? Because Ishmael, even though he was born out of his own flesh, he was his son. He was grievous, but God talked to him. be calm, it's okay, let her go. Because of you, because he is out of your seed, and I will bless him, and I will also make him a great nation. That's our wonderful God. That's our merciful God. Even our failures, even our mistakes, acted out of our flesh, acted out of our distrust, acted out of impatience, and we beget Ishmaels, but God will turn all things around and make it beautiful according to his time and according to his mercy. And God promises him, I will make even Ishmael, because of you, a great nation. So let us act in faith, even though knowing that I may make mistakes, I may fail here and there, and I may stumble here and there, yet even my Ishmaels, God will turn it around and bless it and make a great nation. Our God is such an awesome God. And when Abraham is 99 years old, all he had was a failure, Ishmael. But to this man, 99 years old, dead body, God will give him promise. He says, I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I will make you exceedingly multiplying, and I will make you a father of many nations. Impossible. Impossible. But all things are possible. Nothing is too hard for our God. And he promises that. You know what? I believe that promise given to Abraham is given to you and I, even today. Yes, the same exact promise that God wants you, your life, to be fruitful, exceedingly multiplying, and God wants you, yes, you, who have miserably failed and have begotten only Ishmael in your life, and not a single child has born in your life, not a good fruit you have born until now. Still, God called you, you are a mother of many nations, and you are a father of many nations. I believe that promise has come upon you and I because of Jesus Christ. And I can prove you from Book of Romans and Book of Galatians. And let me just share with you. And if you believe this promise, if you believe this promise, look at your life. And when I look at my life, I feel like Abraham when he was 99 years old. In my ministry, in my whole life, I feel like I only have begotten Ishmael. I feel like I have failed miserably. I feel like I have not borne much fruit yet in his kingdom and in my personal life. And I feel like my body is dead. I'm losing hair left and right too. Don't tell me and don't ask me how old I am. But yet, he gives me this promise. I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I will make you exceedingly multiply. I will make you a father of many, many nations. I will make you father of all nations. I will make you a mother of all nations. Only believe. Do not look at your dead body. Do not look at your Ishmaels. Do not look at your age. Do not look at your circumstances. Hear his voice and grab it, hold on to it, believe it, and pray unto it. And pray unto it. Let me give you a few verses from Book of Galatians, chapter 3, verses 6 and 9. To prove in Christ Jesus all the blessings, all the promises given to Abraham thousands of years ago, those promises are upon your life today, year 2017, January 13, 9:30 p.m. Even as Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. Those of us who believe in the faith of Jesus Christ, we are the children of God. And the scripture foreseeing that God will justify the heathen through faith, you and I, Gentiles. Through faith, we are justified. Preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. Now, when that promise was given to Abraham thousands of years ago, did he have a single child? No. Other than Ishmael, He did not have any child. But that promise is being fulfilled even today in Christ Jesus, because he has already become a father of many nations. In the nations, China, India, America, Latin America, Europe, Middle East, Israel, everywhere, people are being added to the house of God, to the house of Abraham, to the kingdom of God, continually, even today, as I speak to you. That promise, being a father of many nations, exceedingly fruitful, exceedingly multiplying, is still continuing on in Christ Jesus, because you and I are the product of his promise. When God showed Abraham, look at the stars in the sky, look at the dust at the seashore, such will be your descendants if you can count them. And you and I, when God showed the stars and when God showed dust to Abraham, our face, our head, and your body was included in that star, included in that dust. And that promise, through faith in Christ Jesus, is continually being fulfilled and is being multiplied even today. Even today. And here's the thing. The reason why I am so convinced and I believe that promise has a fall upon you and I is because we are the carriers of that promise, just like Abraham. You know why? Because God will continually fulfill that promise. As we carry the gospel of Jesus Christ to the nations, as we preach the gospel, as we make disciples of Jesus Christ, continually more people, stars, and the dust will be added into his kingdom. Because that promise will carry on until he says it's done. Until world evangelization is finished, until he says it is done, it will go on. And us, with that same promise, if we believe, it will be fulfilled. And God will use me like Abraham, serving nations, fathering nations, and mothering nations. And verse 9, so then they which be of faith are blessed with the faithful Abraham. And then Galatians chapter 3, verse 14, here says, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Again, it proves same promise, same blessing that has came upon Abraham has come upon us. And that a passage from Romans, and I don't want to read it because it's a similar passage. In the book of Romans chapter 4, and Apostle Paul gives us an analogy, same way. The promise and blessings of Abraham have come upon us who walk by the faith in Jesus Christ. You are called to be a father of many nations. You are called to be a mother of many nations. Just like you believe in Jesus Christ, believe this promise and trust him. Even though you only had an Ishmael, even though your body is dead, even though your issue of woman has stopped, even though you failed miserably, not following the word of God, but following circumstances. Even though you've been barren in your life, no fruit whatsoever. Isn't it wonderful? He didn't give a promise when Abraham began to bear fruit. Then it can be discouragement to us. But he was still barren. They had no child except Ishmael, except failure. Barren Abraham he was. Yet, God said, I will make you a father of many nations. While he was holding on to that promise, trusting that promise, someday it will be fulfilled. Indeed, a year later, God gave him Isaac. And he only had this son to love. While his vision was for all nations, he was only given with Isaac to love. And it can be like that with our life. While God promises that I will make you a father of many nations, a mother of all nations, a son, a daughter I give under your care. Love that person as if you only have that person in your life. If you are cell leader, love them. Individually care for them as if, I even though God gave me all nations, He is the only brother that I will love in my life. I will pour my life into and invest into this person's life as if He only exists in my life. Such way, love Him. Such way, love her. When God gives you any promotion in your workplace, anything, small thing, only Isaac, God will watch you. God will observe you, how you deal with Isaac. Love that person. Love that brother. Why? Because it's God's way. Even though God loves entire world, God loves all the people in the world. When God sees me, when God approaches to me, He loves me as if no one exists in the world except me. That's how He loves me. And He's more than capable of loving me in such an exclusive way. So when we minister, when we disciple others, when we serve our church, when God allows any brother, any sister under your care, love that person individually as if he or she is the only person in your life to love on. When that happens, due time comes, because you loved that person unconditionally with a Christ love, and when we are proven, God will give us nations continually. And in no time, we realize we have become already the fathers and mothers of many nations. Let us all rise. If I further expound a little bit, in chapter 22, God asked Abraham to forsake and sacrifice his son, only son Isaac, whom he loves, as a burnt offering. Sometimes our ministry can be idolized. Sometimes our career be idolized. Any answer to our prayer, any gift God has given to me can become an idol. And love that more than I love God, then God tests our heart. Because God's gift can sometimes become an idol in my life. But Abraham was proven willing to forsake his only son Isaac, even though he was the only source and channel of his dream of being a father of many nations be fulfilled. He was still willing to let him go. It teaches us a lesson. No matter what, the greatest priority in our life is the intimacy with our God. There should be nothing standing before I and God. It cannot be my husband. It cannot be my wife. It cannot be my son. It cannot be my daughter. It cannot be my career. It cannot be even my ministry or my vision. God has to be all. God has to be first and everything. And after Abraham's obedience was proven, God restates his promise. I will exceedingly make you fruitful and multiply. And I will make you a father of many nations. Dear brothers and sisters, year 2017 is a gift from God. While we uphold the vision of all nations, let us be faithful with our own Isaac. Let us not be bitter over our Ishmael. Let us not linger in our regret because of Ishmael. But let us delight in Isaac and be faithful with him and loving him and thanking God. God will indeed make us fathers and mothers of many nations. I'd like to ask you, if this word really convicted your heart, and if you truly believe God have called you to be a mother and father of many nations, why don't you come forward? Pastors will pray for you. As a token of your faith, as a token of your acceptance of the promises that were given to Abraham, have reached to my life as my calling, as my vision, why don't you come forward? Step out in faith. If you've been barren, if your life was full of Ishmaels, failures, brokenness, good. If you feel like your life has reached a dead end, good. Abraham was like so. But still, to him, God gave this promise. Feel any condemnation or judgment, voice hearing in your head, oh, no, you're not that one. That's an enemy. That's a Satan, not God. We're gonna pray. Lord, I believe. Thank you so much for calling me as a father of many nations and the mother of many nations. Thank you so much. Even my Ishmaels, you will turn them around and make them good. Lord, have mercy upon me. Increase my faith. Increase my patience. Increase my trust in you. Help me to believe in you and sow into prayers in my life until your promise become physical realization in my own life. Help me, Lord. Let's call the name of Jesus 3 times. And pastors, please pray for our brothers and sisters. 1, 2, 3. Jesus.